Well, we should get started then.
Yeah, do it.
Would you have thought a year ago that you'd be having your own Embrace mini festival in your hometown?
If you'd have said like last year that we'd be playing in front of 12,000 people in Leeds and we'd be like number one and we'd be back on Radio 1 single of the week on Colin and Edie. And, you know, sell out tours in America and stuff like that. But I don't know if we really believed it. I guess we must have done to a certain extent because we spent 3 years making the album. And I think we thought this was going to be our last album, as we had every sort of belief that it would be. Let's try and make it, you know, the one of our lives kind of thing.
Yeah.
The sort of, you know, thing you'd want on your tombstone sort of thing.
When I die, I want the whole album and my funeral. I can't decide which one I like best, but I'll have the whole lot. which one? The second album or the third?
Well, I don't know, because well, I don't have Collins at my funeral.
New stuff, every song from the album's a winner. Best album I've bought in a while, so yeah.
If it's going down, then it, you know it's going down. And if it's not going down, then you know it's not going down. That's it.
It took you 3 years to do the album. How, why, and how so long?
It just does take a long time to write really good stuff, and you have to go through phases where you're basically not getting anything, and then, you know, maybe after 6 months or sometimes a year or even 2 years, you get a song that just makes everything else look really rubbish, and so you have to start again. And it took us 3 years to get something that we thought, yeah, this will be all right.
Just keep it going, don't disappear for 3 years again. You know, that was a horrible time, basically. Just give us another album next year.
I'm so glad that they've come back after a few years. I'm really happy for them.
How confident were you all when you finished Out of Nothing?
Very, I think. We were very confident that we'd produced like the best thing we'd done so far, which is like what we went out to, you know, that was our aim, to make the best album we had done in our lives. And I think after we finished it, we all thought that had happened, but we didn't know. We had no idea how it was going to sell or anything like that. You know, we knew it was great, but we didn't know if everyone else would like it.
We went to a meeting with the record label, and me and Danny were sat in the meeting. It was the one where they decided that they wanted to release Gravity as the first single. It was kind of like, well, you know, we've been away for 3 years. Surely we should be coming back with an up-tempo song of our own sort of thing. And I think even Chris said that we were mad for using it as the first song.
What changed your mind?
Mark, who's the managing director of it, basically went, look, you've got to do this because, yeah, it's not necessarily the best song on the album, but it's maybe the best radio song. And he thought that Ashes and Looking As You Are and Someday and stuff would do a lot better after it because of the story, because we've been away for so long and stuff.
Ashes, it's got to be.
No, that's shit, man.
No, Ashes.
But Gravity.
Glorious day, I love. Because it makes you, even when it's raining, it makes you feel really sunny.
Good people.
It's got to be Come Back to What You Know, because My Weakness Is None of Your Business. I like that one, that's a good one.
You're not alone.
Man's Wishing.
Ashes.
No. Glorious day, man. Got to be honest.
Glorious day, come on.
Yeah.
All right, well, Gravity's pretty good too. Fireworks, that's probably a fan favourite. I love that.
Next question.
How long were you sort of in, I'm going to call it, no man's land?
Only about three months.
Yeah. Months, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And we'd kind of decided to, knuckle down and build our own studio at Rick's house. He's got a barn in his garden, and we decided to make that into a studio, so we just got stuck into that.
Yeah.
Whatever happened, we were going to still be making music, and we were going to work and do it on an evening or whatever.
Mm.
And so while we were busy building...
We're quite handy, really, aren't we? You know?
Yeah, we learned a lot of DIY skills. A
couple of little accidents.
It's the next Stephen Eaton.
Yeah, it's kind of like a makeover thing that we're working on.
The lead singer's brother, like, is it Danny? His other guy here, and he's got to sell all his gear to make some money and stuff. Working, real life, we're all working and stuff. To me, that's the defining moment of embracing, and they've come back now.
I reckon a way it probably makes you take things less for granted when you don't have it easy.
Definitely. That's why we're loving it more than ever.
Yeah, I think last summer we'd finished making the album. And we were pretty burnt out after that. It'd been quite an intense sort of 4 or 5 months in the studio with Youth. And then we suddenly realised that we'd got absolutely no money in the group bank account. So after finishing it and thinking, yeah, Gravity's going to come out as a single, it was like, all right, do you want to go find jobs, lads, for like the summer? And that was kind of weird, really, because we felt really proud of the album, but we kept talking while we were making it, you know, does this fit into any scene? You know, is anybody going to care about our comeback? Mm. And then to have to go and work in an office...
Because we stuck out like a sore thumb, really, didn't we?
Yeah. Well, we always have. We've never kind of been part of a scene. We've never really been that cool, but, you know, I think that's kind of part of the survival.
Weren't you working when we were, like, Gravity was Single of the Week?
I was painting a house when you were putting Gravity on Single of the Week, and I was painting a house.
Yeah, you were interviewing me from a toilet in some Manchester radio station, and he was painting and decorating. He was plastic welding. And Mick had got a week off to come out on Ayalata.
I were on a shop floor, and it was... Gravity was being played on the radio all day. They didn't know who I was, and I was just keeping my head down. And then eventually I told the guy there, and it was funny. And I had to ask days off to go on Top of the Pops and see the UK.
It was just a
real
time
to go back the next day.
It was mad.
Never went away for me. Been following him since 1997.
much and love them. But what a comeback.
You read sort of press about when the album came out and everybody kind of refers to it as, or people do refer to it as a comeback. Mm. Do you see it like that?
Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
Well, you know, we got dropped. We didn't have jobs for 3 or 4 months, you know. Playing at the Albert Hall without a record deal is quite a strange dynamic.
Yeah, it was a strange vibe, that, wasn't it? Yeah. Yeah.
Playing the best gig of your life, but also in the back of your head.
But Andy McDonald from the label came to our best of a gig, which was the Tea in the Park festival when we headlined the second stage. Yeah. He came to see us at that, and it was, you know.
Yeah, we were good that night. That was a good gig.
I remember one of my amplifiers like blew up that night, and I didn't even notice because the crowd was so loud. Oh, yeah.
I think it marked a really significant comeback for them.
Yeah, it's a very good comeback album.
I met my partner when we went to see Embrace.
Like, we got engaged at an Embrace gig.
Is it actually the whole album that actually just like set the tone for our relationship, really?
I saw him at V 2001. They were absolutely awesome. First time I saw him. Quality.
Can I bring up V from last year?
Oh,
because
yeah.
That was just, I was in the crowd there and that was just...
I know, I saw you.
Amazing. When you came out, there was one moment just before you came out and you sort of popped your head out right by the speakers just to have a look at the crowd, and that was a magical feeling to be in that crowd that night. That was quite an important moment as well.
Well, we hadn't really done a gig for 3 years, and I got a phone call off Tony, our manager, literally sort of 30, 40 hours before we were due on stage, and he said, are you doing anything this weekend? And I was like, well, you know, garden centre, you know, usual. No, I wasn't a garden centre.
You're in the pub.
Yeah, and he said, well, you are now, you're playing V. And I was like, oh, wow, you know. It's like Jet had pulled out from unfortunate reasons and a bereavement. And so I had the pleasure of being able to ring these people up and say they didn't have to get up for work at 6 o'clock the next morning because I needed them to rehearse because we were playing in front of 30, 40,000 people at the weekend.
The great thing about V, before we even went on stage, and it was like an amazing gig, just the backstage vibe, all these bands coming up and saying, it's so good for you to be back, you know, where have you been, what have you been doing?
Yeah. Yeah.
And that was like quite moving.
Never had that before.
Mm. Really?
Mm. Yeah. Because when we first came out, there was a lot of hype about us, and so that naturally makes everybody else who's in the band go, oh, what's so good about you lot? It gives them a sort of a natural cynicism, which I think is healthy, but, you know, I think if you've survived, you've been through your ups and downs, other bands look at that and think, I hope we can do that, and just, everybody's really nice to us, you know. We did this tent thing, acoustic thing, me and Mick, and I was really nervous, you know. I was like practicing the song outside, going, oh my God, this is, you know, it's live on radio. And it was like sort of all the people in bands and people in the press and radio and stuff, all the sort of schmoozy types all in this tent, all, you could hear the glasses chinking for miles away. Did we do Gravity first, I think, yeah. And they all went really quiet and all came to the front, all these sort of chattering classes types, you know, the type that don't listen, and they all sort of went really quiet. And then at the end of the song, there's a massive eruption of applause. I was like, oh, my God. And that was when I sort of felt that we'd kind of come back, you know.
I was going to say, how did you feel before you went on the main stage?
Really, really excited.
Terrified.
I was so keen to do it, man.
And how did you feel after?
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah.
But the crowd were just, like, mental.
Didn't want to get off. It's kind of like playing the last song and, like, to move my fringe out of my face so I could just see the crowd.
We even, like, they were cheering for so long, we all took a bow, didn't we, as well?
Yeah.
It's like, you know, we hadn't done a gig for 3 years, nobody bought a ticket to come and see us because nobody knew we were playing, and yet they were all singing along to songs we hadn't even released yet. It was like, what's that about? Why was that? What happened?
There was something magical about
that. Why, though? What?
I don't know.
Tell us, because we've got to do it again.
I need to bottle it.
I don't know, there's a warm feeling, you know. Warm feeling when they're doing that stuff.
They did it well, and if they do it as well today, we'll be good.
Well, their music is just so great.
Buzzing, and you just want to play it again and again.
Just brilliant lyrics. Brilliant lyrics, and you just want to listen to it again and again.
Come back to what you know. Take everything real slow.
But I'm not going to sing it. Oh, I just did sing it.
So yeah, their songs kind of keep us together.
You've got incredibly loyal fans who have stuck with you through everything. But you've also, I suppose, with the success of this album, got new fans. Have you noticed that?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, gigs like
a lot more of a younger audience as well. It's completely changed, you know, before on the last sort of tours they were sort of getting older and older, and now it's like just loads of kids there at the front, which is just like it's a whole new energy to people, you know, watching us. It's yeah, it's been amazing.
So I don't really know any of the songs. Well, I followed him since 97. I went to see him at Donnydome. They were awesome then, they're awesome now, and they rock.
Yeah. Well, I've seen them 10 times.
We try and look after them though, really, you know, our fans. We try and do, you know, like we've done the secret gigs, which gives them an opportunity to get a bit closer to us in a more, you know, more intimate acoustic-y thing in a bizarre location like a forest or a cave or something like that.
It was acoustic, it was lovely, it was spot on, it was everything that they're all about, and I'm going to shut up now and I'm going to go away.
Where the band came and played at the competition winner's house.
Which is Les.
Which was me, lucky enough.
Hey.
And it all happened last Monday.
Yeah, look, you can check out the date.
23rd of May.
In London, which was pretty cool. And we all had white balloons and let them go in the middle of the park, and it was really nice.
Because we're all like big fans of music, and like, you know, when we were all growing up, we'd have loved like our favourite bands to do something like that.
Who's been the sort of the ones that stick out in you?
The one that we did with the fans the day after we went to number one, we went out to Parma with seven fans.
Amazing.
And got a super yacht, and it's just amazing. That's probably the peak, I think. And I think now we're going to move forward onto something else that's going to be different from the secret gigs, but it's a secret, so I can't tell you.
Give us a clue.
But it's got to be even more secret because it's kind of even more elaborate and more ambitious.
Harder
to do, yeah.
I hate not knowing. Have you got a favourite moment from this past year then, since Out of Nothing's been released?
Everything's a special moment. You can't just have one moment with the race.
Leeds a couple of years ago, they played him on a little tent, one of my mates upon his shoulders, and he fell off, lost his shoe, never found it again, hopping round Leeds the rest of the time.
And Danny McNamara came over to me and just handed me the guitar. I gave him a guitar, but they gave me the guitar, I just gave it to him because he didn't have enough money for it.
The Parma gig.
Yeah.
That was a bit special, wasn't it?
Him jumping off the side of the boat.
Yeah.
It's pretty funny.
Why was it so special?
Just got to number one.
We kind of booked this secret gig and we kind of thought, right, we'll do it that week because we've not got anything else on. And then we didn't sort of forward think to the point where that's where we would find out what chart placing we'd got. And we never imagined it were going to be number one anyway. We were kind of hoping for top five, you know, like satellite.
But that's only because Gravity did so well before that. We were thinking top ten would be here somewhere.
So it was kind of like it went to number one and then suddenly we were in a swimming pool, you know, with champagne everywhere.
It was like having a holiday, really, wasn't it? It was like working really hard on the album, having to get jobs through the summer, and not really knowing what the fuck was going on, and then suddenly Out of Nothing goes to number one on that Sunday, and then Monday morning at 7 a.m. we were on a flight from Leeds Bradford Airport to Parma with a film crew, and the day after, the seven fans that won the competition, they flew out. And so that was the most elaborate secret gig we've planned, so I think that's why, that's kind of one of the reasons why it was the most special.
Definitely when we found out we were number one, just being at home and just getting the phone call from and Tony, and just jumping around the house with my wife, just going, oh, it's just, you know, just giving that hope that, you know, it's there and we're coming
anything's
back. Everything's going to be all right, basically.
Yeah.
That was it after what we've been through, just to say, yeah, it's going to be fine.
Steve?
I hope tonight's going to be one of the best ones, but I think going to America, I think playing the Bowery and stuff like that, walking on the same stage as like the Ramones and Blondie and all these 70s punk bands, you know. That's the dream when you're in a band, to play these legendary places. You know, for me, that's a big buzz.
Yeah.
You're still hoping for Beavis and Butthead, aren't you?
Yeah, one day we're going to have Beavis and Butthead. And then
The Simpsons.
Simpsons are the ultimate air.
Mine was that moment at V when we were in that tent with all the sort of chin strokers and they all sat down and paid attention, and then the massive applause at the end. I was like, oh my God, people still care. It was like, because I really didn't think that they did.
Mm.
And you know, and I remember Chris saying to me, like, you're coming back with a ballad after 3 years, what are you doing?
But it's very true music, you know, I think. And the lyrics are beautiful and a very, like I said, a very sincere voice, you know, which is cool, man.
And Gravity makes me want to cry.
You're cool and you're quite sexy as well. Sorry, darling. Not as fit as my boyfriend, though, obviously.
He also didn't initially like our version of it either. He was like,
too fast for him.
Yeah. When he first heard it, he was like, just stick it on again. I was like, do you like it? I was like, yeah, I love it. It's great. Stick it on again. It's a bit fast. Stick it on again.
It's a bit fast.
And he was like, is this the finished version? I was like, yeah. He goes, you sure? I was like, yeah. Why? Chorus is too fast, man. Are you sure it's finished? I was like, yeah. Don't you like it? Oh yeah, I love it, it's great. And Gwyneth was in the background going, I can hear that all over the radio, it's fantastic, Danny, you've done a brilliant job. And he was like,
Well, was there any part of you that was worried about that connection with the song, about that being your first one?
The connection side of it didn't bother me at all. I was nervous about coming back with the ballad, I have to say. You know, it really was like a total roll of the dice, and we just got a six, you know. It's like, didn't know how it was going to go. But the association with Chris, I'm really proud of it. I'm totally proud of it, you know.
And Danny dedicated Gravity to me and Laura. So that was quite special. It's a nice moment.
Lovely.
What about in terms of what's next for the next album, and, you know, are you planning that? Have you started it yet?
We want the rest of our year looks like it's going to be split up between going to America and finishing the album.
You just come back from there, haven't you?
Yeah. It was amazing. We spotted Snow Patrol over there, and the crowds that they've got are just... I hope they all come back to see us when we go back on our own. Anyway.
They said they would. Good. I asked them every night.
Tell them the
dates.
The album's kind of more immediate and more sort of drums and guitars, a bit more jumping up and down, and it's going to be, it's going to make our live gigs less kind of lighters in the air and a bit more exciting, I think. And it doesn't feel like we're wearing somebody else's clothes like maybe some of the second album does. It just feels like we're flexing our muscles and growing into what we can become. And like, we've written all of these songs so far, apart from one or two, are written by just the five of us plugging in and playing in a room, and just this magic just happens. It's really quick.
Is the writing process different at all in terms of...
We write as a band now, yeah.
With youth kind of guiding us along the way.
Was that a conscious decision, or did that just kind of...
It was kind of... He said, you know, come over to Spain and we'll do some jamming, because there was a couple of songs on the last album, the last two songs, Near Life and Out of Nothing, came from... just youth bringing vibes in and sort of guiding us to what to do. So we sort of jam for a couple of hours and then he'd edit it together, and hopefully we'll come up with a couple of songs, you know. We came out with about 20 ideas, you know.
24 ideas, of which 12 or 13 are really good.
Yeah, like a great 9 days. Because we actually had to fly back to do the Tsunami benefit concert. So we'd gone to Spain, packed up our gear on the Friday night, flew out on the Saturday morning, straight into Cardiff, and then Sunday flew straight back out to continue.
Yeah, Sunday morning at 5:30, still drunk.
Really rock and roll, because all the flight cases, had some of them had studio written on them, and some of them had stadium written on them. Rock and roll.
I mean, this is incredible. We've sat here with this view of this stage set up in the middle of your hometown. You're getting the keys to the city after the gig.
There's like an Embrace Burger.
Is that? Yeah.
Embrace Bourbon as well.
Yeah, Embrace Bourbon and probably Embrace Haircut.
It's Embrace Barbecue going on somewhere.
It's like, if you look in Leeds...
I don't want to be Embrace hairdressers out there.
No. Leave it.
And the lead singer's hairstyle. Fantastic.
You've seen you're not wearing anybody else's clothes, but you never really have. You've never kind of...
On the second album, we kind of experimented with various different things that kind of weren't really what we were about. But I suppose at that point, we wanted to experiment, so that's where we were at. But
I think we were just reacting to that kind of, oh, here they come, the Northern Balladeering Brothers, you know, with their big strings and, you know...
So it was like, and when we jammed, we weren't balladeers, we were funky jams, and we had punk jams, and we made a different sound to what we put on record, so we just wanted to show a bit of that, really.
Yeah.
Which were our downfall.
So I've done that.
Yeah. And we came back after being away for a year and a half with, like, dreadlocks, a kazoo, I wasn't singing. The video, we were like acting like Mark and Lard in it.
And I was like, yeah, all right then.
That was cool. I'm 32-year-old. No, I'm actually 33-year-old.
I'm not pissed, so. So I'm quite pissed, but I'm not that pissed.
I'm from Leeds. Well, I'm actually from Rotherham.
It's amazing that we survived all that. And I still love that song, I think it's a fantastic song.
That's a little album.
Yeah.
I really like Hooligans, actually.
You all seem really different characters, and do you think that's kind of partly why you're such good friends still, and why you sort of...
We get on a lot better now. We've got a lot of history, we've been through ups and downs. It's like, you know, people who've been in prison or people who've been in the army or whatever, they get on really well.
Comparing me to Bantam. That says a lot, though.
It's a sentence.
When one of us isn't there, it just isn't the same. And we sort of, we all do different things. We all respect each other, and it's like...
It's like being married to four blokes, isn't it, really? Yeah.
We all have different roles as well, you know. It's like I do a certain amount of the talking, Steve does most of the thinking, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah, what does the other three do?
Chipping.
We could be, like, pontificating about anything for ages and ages and going around in circles and getting really wound up.
And arguing, and really Steve quiet just in the go, corner.
And Danny'll say, come on then, Steve, what is it? Well, it's fucking obvious, isn't it? It's that.
It's
that,
like Yoda.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
Up to their
knowledge. Yeah, then they're more like Homer Simpson, thinking about peanuts at the moment.
Where do you think you'll be in, like, 5 years' time?
I honestly don't know. I've got no idea.
Who would you like to be?
Perhaps. I'd like to be on an island with someone who I love. with an allotment and a big beard.
Is that a garden centre again?
It won't be an allotment, will it? It'll just be like a growth.
Well, I'll have a lot of servants, obviously, in the garden.
Or in Vancouver, somewhere in the Rockies or something.
You don't like mountains.
But like with like loads of trees around, cutting trees down and living off raccoons and stuff.
You'd be clubbing it.
How are you feeling about tonight? Is there a sort of raised nervousness because it is a homecoming gig, or is it?
I'm quite nervous.
It's kind of starting to sink in.
It's more like excitement, really.
Yeah. So we've been in the studio all week, so we've had our minds in other places writing and stuff and recording, and until we actually got here and did the sound check, it was like, oh god, yeah, it's happening today, and it felt like
it's like a festival, isn't it? It's like an event gig, really. It's been filmed and stuff like that, and so it's more than just a normal gig. At normal gigs I don't get nervous, but gigs like this, you've got to get yourself into a place where you're excited, and you've got to stay up, otherwise it gets to you.
Because you're doing a DVD.
Yeah.
So it's going to be, everyone's going to be able to watch it for years to come.
Yeah, scrutinise it.
Yeah, so it better be good.
And everyone's turned up now.
The sun's out.
Wow.